Hey crew, I've got the key to that 22 Audi S8. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. The S8 gets a refresh for the 22 model year that includes a now larger hexagonal grille that's blacked out here along with those four Audi rings with the black optic package. There are standard LED matrix headlights. This one has the optional digital LED matrix that can project images onto the road surface. We've got dynamic turn signals and LED DRLs. Down at the corners, we find some of the sensors for the safety features and functional pass-throughs to the intercoolers. This one is painted in ultra blue metallic, and I'm all about this color. It's rich with that nice metallic flake on it. In profile, the black optic package gives us a set of 21-inch 10-spoke wheels. Pretty modest in their design, blacked out. They're wrapped up in Goodyear Eagle F1 Summer Performance tires, 265 section front and rear. From within the wheels, we can see the red painted 6-piston front Brembo brakes, more gloss black accents for the lower sill, door mirrors, and window trim. Stepping back to look at the profile, the S8 is almost 17 and a half feet long, about the same length as an S-Class, but I swear it looks longer because of its straight cut design. At the back, no additional spoiler needed. We do have OLED taillight designs that stretch across the whole trunk lid. There's a black diffuser down low and quad chrome exhaust ports, not blacked out, even with the black optic package. The S8's exterior is clean and sophisticated with just the right amount of flex. Let's look at the interior now. Opening up, and as we do, the optional predictive air suspension will raise up 3 inches to make getting inside that much easier. That along with the very wide opening doors. Looking in, we see a black Valcono leather interior with quilted seats, perforations, contrast stitching, and rear seat heating. On the doors, it's a mix of leather, carbon fiber, gloss black, aluminum, and suede. Here we have some very fun controls. Press this to raise up the back shade. Press this to either shade the front sunroof, ventilate it, or open it completely. You can lift the shade on the back sunroof and raise up both rear sun blinds. Easy to walk on back. And I don't have to close the rear door all that hard because we've got soft close. Look at my legroom situation. This is me behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, and my arms are just barely touching the carbon fiber on the back of the seats. The only complaint about this situation is that the thigh support isn't amazing. The seat bottoms don't extend super far. Headroom is good. And the seat backs have these very padded headrests. Above those is a suede wrapped headliner. And then in front of the rear passengers, we find two vanity mirrors. Down low is a giant drive shaft hub. It's so big, I don't think I'd put anyone in the middle seat. Instead, I'd bring down the dampened center console, which has two hidden cup holders, 4-zone climate control system, lots of gloss black to collect dust, rear heated seats, no adjustments for the seats themselves. If you want to do that, you'll need the optional 4-seater configuration with a fixed center console and those configurations. Under here, we find two USB-C ports. The whole setup back here is, sure, not as extravagant as the Mercedes-Benz S-Class, but the space says luxury to me. And I'm just gonna kind of lounge back here for an extra minute while I talk to you about a crazy cool experience that Omaze is offering right now. If you are an American muscle car fan, I don't need to tell you how special the Buick Regal GNX is. It was built to beat the Corvette, had a turbocharged V6, made 276 horsepower and 360 pound-feet of torque, got the car to 60 in 4.7 seconds, which were wild numbers in the late 80s and are still halfway decent today. Production of these cars was limited to 547 examples, and now Omaze is offering you a chance to win one. Better still, your donations benefit the ACLU, a coalition fighting for U.S. constitutional guaranteed rights. So if you are visualizing a Regal GNX POV drive that starts in your own garage and you want to support the ACLU at the same time Enter for a chance to win at omaze.com/milesperhour. I'll put the info in the video description. And a quick thank you to Omaze for sponsoring this video. Okay, enough relaxing back here. Let's go check out the front. Here's how soft close looks from the outside. Silently satisfying. And then, of course, if you want to slam the door, they sound ultra solid. Up front are heated and ventilated chairs with S logos embossed in them, perforations and quilting like the second row, plus massage. There are S illuminated aluminum tread plates, aluminum foot pedals. There's a standard 17 speaker Bang & Olufsen sound system. You can upgrade this to a 26 speaker unit, more carbon fiber, suede, leather, and gloss black here, two position memory for the seats, four one-touch windows, power adjusting and power folding door mirrors. Pull this tab down here to open up the power operated trunk lid. Inside we find 13 cubic feet of space, which is definitely not class leading. They clearly prioritized rear seat legroom over trunk space, and the only way to expand it is to push down that centerpiece for a pass through. There's a power close and lock feature on the trunk lid. Moving into the front seats. More soft close action for us. I'll put the car in accessory mode, which not only turns on all three of these screens, but it does a neat trick where it reveals the air vents underneath this carbon fiber piece, and then it ushers them out. Below that, we've got real aluminum trim, but then below that, there's just tons of gloss black in here, including on the center console portion here. So this is just gonna collect dust so quickly and show those scratches. Under here, we've got two cup holders. This is a gloss carbon fiber piece on your gear selection. Under the console, you've got two USB ports and a wireless smartphone charging pad. There are two screens. There's a 10.1-inch display up top with haptic feedback, so it gives you kind of this feedback when you touch the actual control. It's quick to respond, has wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Below that, we find an 8.6-inch screen, which is sort of dedicated to your climate settings, along with some shortcuts that you can activate. Then we've got Audi's virtual cockpit system that is reconfigurable and still so cool. It's the second generation of the system. There's a head-up display, stitched leather up on the dashboard, and then there's an S-specific perforated leather-wrapped steering wheel, which is just the right thickness for my hands. Visibility is sublime, and you've got standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. The S8's cabin, to me, is stylish. It's comfortable. It's got good material quality. The only knocks I'm gonna make on it are all the gloss black, and then probably not segment leading technology anymore. Now let's take it for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. I like the sense of occasion. You get the flump from the V8. Then we have the comfort access, bring my seat forward to my driving position, a tilt the steering wheel down, deploy the air vents, and then you got that chime. For our drive mode, to begin, we'll be in Comfort Plus. Not just regular comfort. No. This is the flagship Audi sedan, so Comfort Plus. Then we'll press in here and click forward on the gear selector to bring up a high-resolution backup camera. You also have your bird's eye view off to the side. We can go into a 3D projection. We can scan around the whole car. Nifty. And then look at all of your different views. Front, rear, overhead, wide, narrow, wheels. We'll start with the wide angle rear, which is actually perfect for being sandwiched in by two cars, as you can see around those cars as you're backing up. Safety first. And this is already going to be a test of the turning radius as I attempt to back up in one swoop and a do it. That rear wheel steering system coming into play. We'll talk more about that in a second and do a more thorough turning radius a bit later. For now, without anyone around, we can do the world famous horn test. Dignified. Not all that loud inside. bit higher pitch. It sounds stately. Turn signals. Also modest. Very light tapping. Powertrain. That one's not modest. 4-liter twin turbocharged V8. It's paired with a mild hybrid system and it makes 563 horsepower and 590 pound-feet of torque. That is connected to an 8-speed automatic gearbox and of course the quattro all-wheel drive system. Now one cool thing about the mild hybrid system is that right there, the start-stop function, the car was off and then it was on and you heard nothing of it. That's a V8 coming to life almost completely imperceptibly. And this mild hybrid system is really here for efficiency and convenience and smoothness. It's not here for power. Another cool thing about it is that you can effectively just sit at idle, actually with the car off completely, and let the mild hybrid system run all of your electronics, including the air conditioning system, without you needing to turn on the car. Try doing that in a normal car in accessory mode, and you're just going to kill your battery very quickly. Cruising along in the S8 is so effortless. There's so much power here that you barely need to brush upon the throttle to motivate you. The adaptive suspension with the air springs keeps the ride supremely smooth. Dual pane acoustic glass with a laminate coating stays quiet. The seat padding is a touch on the firm side. It doesn't completely disrupt the comfort here. These are just not the plushest seats I've ever sat in. We'll have a chance now to do a turning radius test. I mentioned the rear wheel steering system, which can turn the rear wheels in the opposite direction of the fronts at low speeds. To do that, to take a giant sedan with a very long wheelbase and make it just pivot. The 8-speed automatic, sitting on the back burner, not noticeable in the way that it moves between the gears. The ride quality, to return to that for a second, it is fantastic, especially here in Comfort Plus. Part of that is because you've got an active suspension system. So similar to the Rolls-Royce flag bearer system where you've got a camera scanning the road ahead for road blemishes and then priming the suspension to take those bumps. I will return to that suspension diagnosis in just a sec, but first let's take the S8 to 60 miles per hour. In preparation for that, I've got my race box set up here and then I'm going to go into the dynamic drive mode, which will also put us in sport powertrain. I'm then going to hit the traction control button once for sport traction. I'll then hold my foot hard on the brake, pin the throttle, build up some revs, and get us off the line quickly. Here goes. All mercy. 3.7 seconds? That was aggressive. I recognize we have 563 horsepower, but this is no featherweight, this car. That quattro all-wheel drive system just rocketed us. Zero slip, no drama, 3.7 on the dot, which is what Audi quotes, but I'm particularly impressed with that because we were on a slight uphill to start,
And I mean, I hadn't primed the tires or anything. We just went. So you can bet the S8 will get to 60. Can't even talk right now. To 60 quicker than 3.7 seconds. What a beast this thing. But is the S8 just a 0 to 60 launch, or does it have anything in the mid-range? We'll click the gear selector over into manual mode. I'll use these very dinky paddles on the back of the wheel. Rip down some gears. Oh! Fierce acceleration. Little delay in the downshift. This is a missile. This car hurtles down the roadway. Ah! Sorry. Really enjoyed that. That was wonderful. The brakes are also so easy to modulate. I needed to scrub speed. I just gave the pedal a little bit, and it so gently brought us back down to speed. In manual mode, the shifts are not stupendously quick. They are indeed quick, but you just have to wait that half a second. At least on the downshift, those upshifts, rifle quick. This car would embarrass some very high profile, very expensive performance cars. Would just leave them for dead. What an animal. And then just as easily you can go back into Comfort Plus or Auto or Individual, where you can calibrate different things like the steering feel and throttle response. We'll go into Auto. And then you're back in your executive saloon, cruising comfortably. Okay, return to the ride quality for just a sec here, because the flag bearer system, it's not flag bearer, that's Rolls-Royce, their advanced warning system, predictive, I don't know what they call it, predictive electromechanic air suspension, sure, works most of the time. I have, however, encountered a situation where the bump is extra harsh, and though the suspension may be primed, perhaps it's not engineered well enough to absorb the bump. So the suspension really does crash in those circumstances. They are very rare, but it does crash. You hear it and you feel it. The vast majority of the time, however, you're just floating down the road. At ease, in comfort. We are not quite finished with the S8's performance and handling, though. So I went back into dynamic mode, kept it in sport traction, and we're going to carry some speed into this curve to first put those brakes to the test, and then see about everything else. Here it goes. Hard on him. Scrub that speed. Turn in is quick. A little understeer under power. Body stays flat. And then you could feel that torque vectoring rear differential just ushering the power to the outside wheel and slingshotting us out of that curve. This is a monster, this car. Some things I really liked. The flatness of the body. They did a lot to the suspension, having that rear wheel steering system turning the same direction as the fronts now at high speed to effectively lengthen the body and give us that extra stability. The torque vector and rear differential, loved that. Didn't love so much the steering feel. There wasn't a great amount of communication through that rack, and there was a touch of understeer. You could cure it with a dollop of extra power, but just a little bit of power kind of push the front of the car to the outside of the curve. For the size and weight and class of this car, that was remarkable. Now let's go back to Comfort Plus, turn traction back on fully, and get some highway cruising in. I won't activate him right now, but if you want, oh my goodness, this car just, you have no idea how quickly you are traveling unless you're actually looking at the speedometer. Clearly built for the German Autobahn, this car. You're just a blue bullet hurtling down the road. Anyway, if you want to see the adaptive cruise control system and the lane keep system in action, and if you want to hear that Bang & Olufsen 17 speaker sound system, go ahead and watch my POV night drive. For right now, I'll just reiterate how well insulated this car is while traveling at a high rate of speed in comfort. You're just encouraged to take long drives in the S8. You stay fresh, you stay fast. Let's talk pricing and competition now for this 22 model. The starting figure is just under $119,000. This one is tested though, is $135,500. The fuel economy is 14 mpg city, 23 on the highway, and 17 combined. The worst of the vehicles I'm about to share, which include the 23 BMW 760i xDrive. That one starts at $114,500. It makes 523 horsepower. It gets to 60 in 4.2 seconds. The fuel economy is 20 combined, and the cargo space is more than the S8. Another one to share, the Mercedes-Benz S580. Because we do not have the new AMG S63, that's the best we can do right now. That one starts at $117,000. It makes 496 horsepower. It gets to 60 in 4.4 seconds. The fuel economy is 20 combined like the BMW, and the cargo space is also more than the S8. Things I like about this S8 relative to the competition. For one, it is styled in a more incognito way. It's more fly under the radar, and I do mean absolutely fly under the radar, but you're more covert about your power and style and essence and luxury than certainly the S-Class, and I don't love how the new 7 Series looks. Inside, you've got loads of passenger volume. In the back seat, in the front seat, you can really stretch out. And then finally, it just is an absolute rocket ship. This thing is so fast down the roadway, and 0 to 60, mid-range, in a corner, everywhere, it's quick. Things I don't love about it. I've already bemoaned all the gloss black. I have also shared that the technology is not class-leading at this point. The new 7 Series with the screens in the back and the S-Class with the big OLED display in the center, those are really carrying the segment in terms of technology. The seat and ride comfort are not quite at the plushness level of the S-Class. And then finally, the trunk size is just very small for how big the vehicle is. All that to say, this feels to me like the driver's choice of the vehicles I mentioned. At least until there's an S63, and at least until there's a proper M7, this just hauls in a way that those other cars do not, while staying comfortable and staying low-key. You feel like Jason Statham in Transporter, you really do, with a few less jumps onto trains, perhaps, but the same bossness that's here in this car. I think if I had a more dedicated performance car that I drove every weekend, I might choose the S-Class for all-around luxury and tech and comfort. But if I didn't, if I wanted all in one, that's the S8, guys. I hope you've enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I will see you again next time. There we go. Ooh.